warp gate's prepared yet.
You need to try and pick off the units as.
Look at the shields on the warp gate.
Oh my god, the drone is gonna take them!
What's up, guys? We are back. This is Pain User.
And this is Cat's Pajamas.
And we got game two for you guys between Complexity's Stake in the bottom left as our Green Terran. And in the top right, we have Six Jacks Coco. The map is Crossfire. And good lord, siege tanks are so good on this map.
You took the words right out of my mouth. Look, folks, here you have Zelnaga Towers, and all around that you have a trillion, I counted them in my sleep, ramps, and all of those are easily defended by key siege tank positioning.
You've
siege
got
tanks.
Cliffs, you've got ramps, you've got chokes, you've got pretty much everything you need. Every terrain advantage you could possibly imagine for the siege tanks. There, you in the middle of the map. Where there aren't ramps and cliffs, you have giant chasms where you can siege tanks on both sides and prevent units from getting to them. I mean, this map could not be designed any better for the siege tank if you tried. One thing that the map developers, or the creator, I'm not sure how many people worked on it, but tried to do to prevent that was add all of these different avenues of attack around the right and left. I mean, there's just multiple angles that you can take to get from point A to point B, and that's something that you'll see some of the really outstanding players on this map. I know I've seen Rhett a few times, and Idra, and White Raw really utilize those ulterior attack paths to flank their opponent and really make something happen when a Terran is in a super advantageous position.
Oh yeah, I've also seen White Raw do some beautiful like warp prism timing attacks on this map and things like that. Just skirt the vision of the Zelnaga Tower, warping units behind, force the siege tanks back, attack through the front. Pretty easy strategy, but it works really, really well here.
Yeah, I mean, and we have two Terrans here, so I can't help but think that this is going to be a full-blown tank war. This map usually always comes down to that. You're not going to see either of these players go bio, really.
Right.
I just don't see that in the cards. So
yeah, I mean, drops are possible and things like that.
Yeah, I mean,
it's a relatively long distance from base to base, so we'll see what happens. It looks like both players are opening the same way once again. Gas, pretty typical opening. Looked like 10, 12, 13, 15 opening, everything we're used to. Stake, though, putting down a tech lab on his barracks right away. Reaper openings are kind of clever here. A fast expand is definitely viable. Once you get a couple of siege tanks out, I mean, just like it is all the way across the map, a couple of siege tanks right here, and you're defended against basically every attack route into your natural. So Reaper openings are pretty good here.
Yeah, I actually really like Reaper openings on this map. They allow you to hold the Zelnaga for so long, and I feel like that's a really pivotal role on this map. You need to hold the Zelnaga Towers as often as possible. At the very minimum, hold your own Zelnaga Tower, because that is such an important territory on the map. If you let your opponent establish an advanced position on this map outside of your natural or just at your Zelnaga, and we have a very quick command center coming down right now for Stake, and it looks like he is going to follow this Reaper up with a barracks.
There we are.
I was waiting for the Marauder Marine call, but then a barracks came down. So we do have a second barracks coming down, and it looks like this Reaper is just going to pass right by that SCV, clear out the Zelnaga, and ooh, is he going to cross paths with this SCV on the way back? It looks like he might. Yeah, he
yes,
is going to take
will.
Out this SCV, and then probably head right over to the other Zelnaga, take out that Marine, and establish a position over there. So this Reaper already doing so much for Stake.
Yep, absolutely. Two units gone. He's going to be able to do some scouting as well, forcing those units for Cocoa to defend. And look at this. Hidden starport in the top left-hand corner. Now this Reaper, if he goes the way I think he will, he's going to go around the back here.
Oh, here it comes, Kevin.
It's killing Taylor. Here comes Stake, though. He's going to make his way up, and there's the Starport. Hello, Starport. How are you doing?
Oh,
I'm a Reaper.
At least he got the Reaper.
Yep, no more kills for the Reaper, so it does go down. Command Center up as well. And I got to say, this is actually the same timings on the build we saw last game as well. So this was a prepared build. He has this worked out for a specific situation, but it just leaves him with so few units at the beginning of the game.
Investing in that Viking, not building Marines constantly, not getting a reactor on the racks, you're definitely foregoing all those early game units. He's all, ooh, and we have double reactors coming out of Stake here. Stake looks to be going with a bio composition here. Combat shields already on the way. We do have a factory just now being dropped, as well as the second gas. He's going to have his natural expand up quite a bit before Coco here. Going to run away with that macro lead just a little bit. But for the time being, he's content to just produce SCVs in his main and really get those numbers up.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's not a terrible idea either. I mean, I've seen a lot of players that'll just really quickly saturate one base, go up to a couple of drops, and expand behind that. Nice positioning, though. I mean, it's those little things you do that really separate players apart. And Cocoa knew those units were coming, sits himself in a position that it was going to take the longest possible time for these Marines to actually do damage, and gets a couple free hits there with that Hellion.
Yep, and now forcing Stake to maneuver around the map, trying to find this Hellion. It looks like he is devoting, quite a bit of his time and effort into this, and it looks like it will pay off. Going to take that Hellion out, deny any kind of further scouting information, and this will allow him to securely take his natural expansion. We do have Coco moving out here. Nope. He's just going to send that Viking in for scouting purposes, figure out exactly what's going on. He will run into that natural expansion, and it doesn't look like Coco is going to be able to push before Stim finishes here. Stim at about 55%. Mm-hmm. By the time Coco is able to get over there with any kind of a tank marine force, Stim will be finished, and he will be in a possibly dangerous situation.
And it looks like Stake is just going to go for the aggressive bio drop route. There we go. There's the tech lab coming up for the factory. So he is going to reinforce with tanks as well. So he's going to concede the initial tank advantage, but try and push his way ahead in macro and hope that that pays off and he can eventually do these pesky little drops until he can equalize those mech numbers. So there we go. Stake with a bunch of units there up front. He does have his tech lab being constructed. Let's take a look at the units tab. He is actually, he wasn't producing workers that entire time, and he's not producing off his second orbital. He has let Coco catch up in economy.
Yeah, Coco has most definitely caught up. He was sitting on his orbital as well, although he did drop that CC a little bit later. He's been able to equalize that. We do have a bunch of unupgraded Marines here for Coco, and they are not going to be able to stand tall for very long against these fully upgraded Marines of Stake. He is moving in with a ton of Marines and a Marauder right now, but Coco already established at that ever-so-important position that I was discussing earlier. The Zelnaga Tower is so important. This is just going to allow Coco to maneuver to the third as well as drop at the natural, and he just has so much vision and control over the map at this point. One thing that he really needs to be careful of is a possible backstab, but he has control over the middle of the map, and that is so important in TVT.
Absolutely. So Stake going to flank his way around now and try and get to the side of these units, which could be pretty effective, especially if he can draw the fire of the siege tanks to the front for a little while. And it looks like Stake's going to make his way up. This Marine was patrolling back and forth, looking for any rogue units around the side. And it looks like Coco knows that's happening, knows he can't save these tanks, immediately packs up, starts to retreat. There's the scan down from Stake. Knew his opponent was going to be headed out. And it looks like he secures the middle of the map.
Yep, middle of the map is fully secured for him. Forces Coco to pull back. Coco looks like he's going to set up a relatively safe defensive position here. Already has a tank sieged at the natural. And wow, Coco double pumping tanks right now off of two factories, working off of four Raxes as well. And we do have Stake adding some tanks into the mixture here, just opening with that bio style, really getting those Marine numbers up. And now he is also pumping tanks off of two factories. So both players respectively pumping siege tanks at about the same rate. But keep in mind, Coco did have those early numbers of siege tanks added into his army, so he will prevail in that sense. But there are so many Marines out for Stake, and they are fully upgraded.
Yep, absolutely. He is going to be behind in terms of weapons upgrades. He just now finished up his engineering bay and just started weapons level 1, but he is going to a third base as well. So he is going to try and take a huge macro advantage, and frankly, that's not a bad idea in TVT in this map, because he can use so few siege tanks to protect his lines. As long as he has sight of everything he needs to with the Zelnaga Tower control, he should be able to pretty safely expand. Looks like he's going to make his way over here to the top left. Got to watch out, though. Coco's making his way in, and we may have a little bit of a standoff here.
Yep, both players using the terrain to the best of their ability, but it looks like Coco might have been able to push just far enough that he will be able to slowly secure this Zelnaga tower, and if he's able to do so, it's going to put Stake in a position. Well, actually, Stake looks like he's just going to go around the left here, possibly set up a flank. He will get spotted by this Zelnaga in just a little bit here. Yes, he has been spotted, so Coco looks like he might just opt for a base trade here. I'm not sure what both players are doing right now, just kind of fighting for position in the middle of the map. And oh my god, Stake engaging with all of his
brains there. Wow, and he just lost a lot to those siege tank bursts. So he is going to have to pull back. Coco has actually pulled ahead in supply quite a bit. He's only up by a couple of workers as well, so most of that is in army. He himself is establishing another base here at the top left, and that's before Stake is going to be able to call down his next one, which he has forgotten about. Looks like he is going to move up to the top left, deny the construction of this third. But yeah, Stake really has to start figuring out this orbital command because he doesn't have that ready to go. Oh, scan does go up to the top, prompts Coco to start doing a little bit of damage as well. So just tanks trading at the moment.
Stake needs to be much more careful with his Marines. That's the second time in this series we've saw him lose quite a few Marines to several siege tanks. You need to put them on a hold position, and ooh, it looks like Coco is just creeping his way into the natural of Stake. Stake losing a few tanks here, and he is being pressured into a situation where I would not feel comfortable at all. There are Vikings spotting the high ground here. He has several tanks creeping into the natural. It's going to be very difficult for Stake to reinforce this, but it looks like Stake is setting up for a flank here. He's going to take the Zelnaga back, and he's going to siege tanks up on the backside, and he might be able to get a very nice pincer movement here.
Oh, here we go. So now all of those tanks are sieging themselves up. Coco is trying to position his units so it doesn't take fire from each side, but he can't help it. Look how many Marines are falling right now. Coco is going to lose so much here, and he just simply can't move. It doesn't matter what kind of vision he has, he cannot move. He will have his entire force obliterated sooner or later, but it looks like he himself is trying to find a way to break those units out by counterflanking the flank.
His best bet might be either to counterflank the flank and collapse, sandwich that force in the back for Stake, or he could start elevating his units out of there immediately and try and salvage as many tanks as possible. It looks like he is content to just kind of hang out here, but he does continue to suffer losses. He's continuing to lose units, and I don't know if he's in a position to do that right now.
No, not at all, especially because he's down that base as well. He did put up another command center, but he's not producing off his third. It looks like Stake's economy is going to get much better. He's got called down a couple of mules, but here we go. Those Marines try to break themselves out, but they simply can't. Just a couple of siege tanks remaining. Here come the rest of the forces for Coco, though, and that is going to allow him to break the position, but at the cost of quite a few units. Stake has equalized the supply, and he's up a base.
Yep, and that base that he is up on could be his salvation. He's going to need to really... Oh my god, floating 900, 1200 right now. Yeesh, gotta add some more production facilities into the mix here. Coco not floating nearly as many resources. He's probably been investing more of that into army, more of that into infrastructure. He's also taking his third right now. Both players fighting for position here at the third, and it looks like Stake will be able to get his tanks in position, but they might not be far enough forward, and there's a potential to lose his third right now.
Yep, and he is going to pick up and try and move away. That means that a Viking is going to start shooting that, but he is going to save it. Coco's not going to be able to advance into the siege tank line quite yet, but at the same time, Stake has a ton of units that are running rampant through the middle of the map. He may be able to pull around behind here and completely pincher this force off once again. This is some very, very interesting tank positioning war we have going on here. Brilliant moves out of both these players so far.
Yeah, they're actually both doing a great job flanking, counter-flanking, using the different avenues on the map to force sieges and un-sieges. You know, right now, Coco in a pretty precarious situation. He could eventually be cut off. He could get all of these siege tanks killed, and they are firing at each other right now. Both players scanning away, trying to get a beat on where the opponent's tank line is, but neither player really willing to commit right now, just kind of chilling on the tank line here.
Yep, and Coco does unseize, and it looks like he's going to pull back for the moment. Now, he himself does have a planetary fortress up here at the top left, so he is working off of three bases. Granted, it's not in orbital, but that's okay. Stake will establish this third here pretty quick again, and it looks like he's going to pull that away, possibly back to a different expansion over here at the 3 o'clock, maybe over to the gold, but it looks like Coco is going to siege himself here at the Zelnaga Tower. He's Stake has to watch out. He's going to lose a lot of units without a couple of key scans. Scans are going down at the moment, but he has, in fact, lost the siege tank. So once again, both players almost max, and we have just a giant positioning war here in the middle.
Yeah, neither player looking to commit at this point in the game. They're just trying to feel each other out, find a position where they can make a break, and bring his orbital back and eventually going to head over to the left side here. Looks like he wants to take that third, not in the bottom right-hand corner. And I find this kind of interesting because I definitely feel like he could have reestablished his position in the bottom right after warding Coco out of there, but choosing to give that up entirely and spend the extra airtime floating this all the way from the bottom right.
Interesting, and he's going to drop a bunch of units over here at the left as well, try and outflank this force, which is not a bad idea. Oh, he already does see the command center going up at the gold. He's going to be able to deal with that. Marines are coming in, though, to reinforce, and eventually Stake will lose that Marine. There it goes. But he has a lot of units over here at the left. It looks like he's going to send out a task force to start doing some damage. He also has this fourth orbital command sitting inside of his main. That was, I was wondering where all those scans were coming from because I saw his one orbital command lifted up, but that's where they were. So Stake does manage to cancel that. He could pick himself back up in these and just run away. Oh, looks like he is going to avoid this huge column of tanks moving around, though. So both players pulling themselves back to their respective corners of the map.
Ooh, and we do have a drop here coming in for Coco. It looks like this might be able to do quite a bit of damage. Well, actually pulling his SCVs immediately. Stake not suffering too many losses right there. Coco just now relocating those Marines, so they are in range of the SCVs mining gas. Going to be able to pick off a majority of these. Yes, he does get four of the SCVs mining gas, so well played by him. And we do have another gigantic siege tank line in the middle of the map. And, you know, that drop from Stake at the third, originally I was questioning that. I wasn't sure exactly why he didn't just go for Coco's third. I feel like that drop, four medevacs worth of units, would have been able to do quite a bit of damage. But he went for the more defensive play, secured his third expansion for certain, and now it is turning into a situation where Coco is laying siege to this third, or perhaps going for a position here at the Zelnaga. It looks like Stake is trying to react. He does have quite a few units here at the Zelnaga. And no, Coco got to pull out of there.
Uh-oh, but it looks like he may be... Oh, God, he doesn't know if he wants to commit or not, but I think he is going to try and push forward here. But, oh no, Stake unseizes himself. He's got to get sieged up again. If he does, oh wow, Coco's sitting just outside of this Zelnaga range. Now he's going to move in. Oh no, that was a big blunder. He loses two siege tanks, almost a third, and four or five Marines for free.
And we do have a giant pack of Marines here heading in for the flank, possibly to try and go camp the production line or hit the natural, seeing as how a majority of the units for Coco are out on the field here. And Coco getting into a similar spot where his units are getting pincered, and all of these Marines running into the main right now, they're going to be able to do so much damage. Tanks going down, bunker goes down, Marines are down in the front, and his base is wide open. Second stim going down, and this could change the game.
Absolutely. Coco is going to be forced to pull back right here, and that is exactly what you don't want to do. Whoa! Look at all those SUVs dying one after another after another. Natural does fall. The units starting to stream their way in for Coco. He's not going to be able to siege himself up quite yet, though. He does have some units inside of the main, but it doesn't matter. So much out here for Stake. He's going to be able to deny production as well. Getting back, now he is finally going to have to engage his force. Heads up. Final stim goes down. Not going to be able to save his units, but he already did his damage. He denied the natural. He's way up in supply. He's up in upgrades, and he's going to continue this dropping here over at the 10 o'clock position.
Yeah, Stake looking absolutely phenomenal at this point in the game. Just very cool under pressure. I feel like Coco has had a few positions during this game that, you know, are very, very dicey for Stake. Once outside of his natural, then once again outside of the third, but Stake just keeping things cool, able to remain calm and ward him out of those positions. And now he's in a situation where he's actually ahead. So playing so well. And, you know, I've got the feeling, I'm just going to go out on a limb here, whoever takes this game, because this is such a long game. Both players are just giving it everything they have. Yeah. There's so much positioning involved. This is going to take a lot out of either player. I feel like whoever wins this game might just take the series.
And Sake's got to watch his macro as well. He's at 2,100, 1,300 still. He's still just working off of the production facilities he was before. Just four racks, four factories. He needs to ramp up that production here very soon, because as soon as he forces a frontline engagement, he will suffer losses, and it may come down to whoever can reproduce their army the fastest.
I totally agree with that. He does not have nearly enough racks, I don't think, to support this kind of late-game production that's necessary to remax your army after a big fight. It'll be very difficult for him to get all those Marines back, especially the ones that he just lost, pushing into Coco's natural. Look, Coco's going after the third here, going to take out both those tanks.
Oh, but he loses a lot of Marines in the meantime as well. These tanks on the high ground have been very valuable for Stake. At the same time, he's going to move up with another huge group of Marines. Marines and Marauders. So,
where is he getting all these Marines?
Man, I don't know.
He only has four Raxes, two of which don't have add-ons right now. So.
And yeah, that's very interesting. But he's just, you know, it may be more of an example of he's been very, very smart with them so far. He hasn't engaged them when he shouldn't. Oh, but it looks like he may get these pinched off. He has to run around here down to the right. Coco does stim up. That's going to force Stake to turn around, starts doing damage, and his Marines are actually less upgraded, but because Coco didn't really commit, he started to pull away, was letting those Marines do extra damage. Stake is actually able to draw even in that engagement.
Yeah, Coco actually just over-microing a little bit there, stutter-stepping a few times where it wasn't necessary, and not really increasing his concave to the maximum that he might have achieved.
So, yeah.
You know, not the best battle micro right there. Probably lost to a smaller number of Marines.
Oh, boy.
I know. We do have battle cruisers coming out of Stake here. We do have the starport farm erecting in the bottom right-hand corner. And he is getting that fusion core and dual armory. So we are going to be seeing quite a bit of air upgrading here. The same is actually going on for Coco. He does have air armor on the way. I don't know how many starports he has right now, though, nor does he have the fusion.
Oh, and he's just going to run right into this army, and look at the tanks from the tanks from Stake are doing so well. Took out that initial line of Marines, but Coco is reinforcing pretty well. He's drawing Stake off of this position, and really Stake is going to play that style of game that's just waiting until he can start producing those battle cruisers. He does have the fusion core almost done. It's been kind of interesting. He finally finished up a couple of supply depots, but he was sitting on 188 max supply for almost 10 minutes in the game. So thought that was kind of interesting, because if Coco had forced a frontline engagement there, he may have won with just pure superior numbers.
So would you say that he's staking it to him?
Guys, these aren't going to end. You better just bear with us. So, so Stake going to pull back with all of his medevacs now. He's got a lot of siege tanks here in the middle. And our first cattle bruisers are not coming out yet, but they will be started here pretty soon. All of the tech labs finishing up as well. He's going to get himself some gas is what it looks like. How much gas is he mining? There we go. Starting a couple more refineries here over at the gold. And he is sending out, well, a lot
of
medevacs.
Empty medevacs.
A bunch of medevacs with about six or seven Marines.
Looks like he might have units rallied there. His reinforcements may be rallying into there. He should bring some tanks with this drop. I feel like if he was able to sneak a drop like this into the main with some siege tanks, he could achieve quite a bit. Getting in on the production facilities of a Terran, obviously in TVT. I mean, camping a Terran's production is enough in any matchup, but in TVT, tanks just add a whole nother element to the term camping someone's production.
Yeah,
I mean,
absolutely.
Each unit that comes out just instantly explodes.
Oh, money scan.
And the ghost gets scanned. Oh, man, that was a very, very timely scan right there. That ghost not going to be able to accomplish anything. Both players continue to play the positioning war in the middle of the map. No one taking a clear advantage right now. We have the map completely split in half.
Yep.
Both these players are on four base. And we are in for the long haul.
And Cocoa is supply cap, putting up three supply depots at the same time, and he's got to get those up quick. Otherwise, he'll be significantly behind in terms of army. Here's the big drop that you were talking about before. It's going to make his way here to the top right. There's only one missile turret here ready to stop this. That's not going to be near enough. So it looks like Cocoa is bringing all of his army back, but is he going to be moved back in time? Here we go. Stake dropping down all of his Marines. There is one siege tank up, but he is stopping the tech labs on most of these factories. Very, very quickly, and this siege tank indeed will fall along along with a bunch of these medevacs if he's not careful. It looks like these production facilities were being shot down, however. So State going to move back, not doing as much damage as I would have thought he would have done initially, but it looks like he is picking off those very expensive, very long-to-produce add-ons.
Yes, indeed. He's going for whatever he can. He is just going to kill as many important buildings as possible before all of these Marines breathe their last breath. No, he will pick up. Nope, he will not.
Nope, but that does clear up room for cattle bruisers. Our first three are coming up at this time. Oh, they take so long to produce. That is ridiculous.
They certainly do.
And they are so expensive. But I tell you what, almost nothing scarier than about 10 battle cruisers staring down your army.
I know something that's scarier.
Yes.
I know a few things that are scarier.
Yes.
They give me nightmares.
20 nukes in the same place? DTs?
DTs.
The DTs!
Why do you think there's a DTs give me nightmares shirt? There's good reason behind that. But we do have a gigantic Marine tank force here on Coco's side of the map. But the one thing Coco doesn't know is that Stake, all the while, is continuing to add these battle cruisers slowly but surely. He is maxing out, and he's also hiding them in a pretty solid location. Going to be difficult for that to get scanned unless Coco is looking for something very specific. Coco, once again, trying to get something accomplished with a ghost, but it will once again be taken out with a timely scan.
Yep, absolutely, and here we go. Two more battle cruisers are making their way up. That's going to be three in total. It just seems so fast to me. I know this was a little while ago when their speed got buffed, but still. Coco going to drive his way in now, and he's going to push his way into a huge siege line. I don't know if that was the smartest idea, and he is going to be disappointed when he sees all of his Marines gone and battle cruisers ripping apart his siege tank line. He does have a few Marines left, and he has enough medevacs that he can support them for quite a while. Ooh, wow, these battle cruisers actually have to back up for the moment. A couple more going to make their way in, and these medevacs are starting to go down one after another. It looks like he's going to move directly into this planetary fortress. Stake, though, very nice job reacting very quickly. One battlecruiser does fall. It's done some damage, but Stake needs to reinforce with a few units so he can neutralize those Marine numbers and let those battlecruisers do their damage.
Yeah, I don't know if the BCs were the best possible switch here. It looks like it might come back to bite him. Those BCs getting taken out by these 3-3 upgraded Marines, not relatively easily. But the BCs do have 2-2 now, so they will be able to hold their own against these highly upgraded Marines. And we do have BCs coming down now towards the bottom right to save his original third. But there are Marines in the mineral line, and all these tanks are going to siege up. It's going to be up to the BCs here. Can they kill the Marines and get these tanks out of here?
I think they can. They're doing so much damage to the tanks. These Marines have not engaged the BCs yet. And like four or five tanks have already fallen. Looks like these BCs going to get in, do their damage now. Those 2-2s, so powerful. And they have so much armor as well. Doesn't even matter that these Marines are 3-3 and supported by medevacs. Well, this group of Marines will. That'll be able to take out a couple of BCs very quickly, but Stake is ripping through the siege tank line. All the rest of these units have fallen. Nice flank as well. Stake knows these units were coming up, and look at the rest of these tanks. They are going to fall so quickly, unseized to these Marines.
What an intelligent move from Stake right there, flanking all of the tanks. They were by themselves. They were not protected, and those tanks going down to that small number of Marines. Oh, he is sending those Marines up into a death trap here. Going to lose all of them for virtually nothing.
Yeah.
And that hurts.
Yep, that does hurt, but he does have the fleet. Too cold in the fleet. There are five battle cruisers over there already. Another one coming up as well. And right now, Stake does have a huge supply advantage, 178 to just 112. Cocoa has been mined out of his bases for so long. He's trying with everything he has to make that last mining base viable, but it's going to be very difficult for him to walk into this siege tank plus battlecruiser line.
Yeah, the BC's supplementing very, very well right now. He is trying to counter the BC's, it looks like, with an almost purely Marine style, and I don't know if that's going to be able to cut it. With siege tank support, those BC's are just going to become almost invincible.
Yep, absolutely. And it looks like Coco may be down to his last legs because this was his only mining base. As we can see, just take a look at his mineral intake right now. There it is. 176. And now, granted, yes, Stake isn't mining anything, but he's got the vastly superior force, and he will win in a straight line engagement.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more, and he is headed in right now. Coco pressing the action at the natural. He has more than enough to clean up these Marines, and he's going to head straight into the main. Look for him to start camping that immediately. On the same note, Steak is pushing. Oh, and Coco just abruptly GG's there. I don't think he had anything to deal with these BCs. No. He wasn't mining.
Nope. He knew the game was stakes, and that is good GG timing. Nothing he could do. There was no way he was going to reestablish this mining base with this many BCs standing in his way. So there we are. A 40-minute game where all but two bases are mined out on Crossfire, and we kind of expected that right from the onset. This is the land of the siege tank.
The land of the siege tank, indeed. That game really just showcasing how important the siege tank is as a key role player in this matchup, and also how important the siege tank is as an important player on this map.
Yes.
Siege tank's so important, and all of that positional warfare really just revolving around that unit in particular. So
there we are. Not much else to be said about it. It looks like Coco does fall in game two, so Steak ties it up 1-1. We're going to head into game three here in just a second, so don't go anywhere, guys.